Hi from the Grio. I'm your co-host, Dr. Christina Greer, and today we have a special guest co-host.
Hi, I'm Tanisha Ford, professor of history at the Graduate Center CUNY, and you're listening to What's in It for Us.
There's so many things we have to talk about. I've been following your Twitter feed. Obviously, I've just loved talking to you for well over a decade. So today, I want to talk to you about the passing of hip-hop legend DMX, which has hit me in a way that I did not expect for it to. The video recording of military officer Caron Nazario, who was pulled over by the police, and the brutality he experienced. And of course, this happened months ago, and we're just now seeing it. And then lastly, the quote-unquote accidental police shooting of Daunte Wright in Minnesota and all that's followed suit. So what are your thoughts on those three topics?
The passing of hip-hop legend DMX left me gutted. The video recording of Officer Caron Nazario was heartbreaking, but to be expected at this point in many ways. And the so-called accidental police shooting of Daunte Wright raises larger questions about police procedures and the need and the cause to abolish the police.
I know that's right. I cannot wait to dive in with that. So as always, dear listeners, you all are listening to What's in It for Us, and we will continue to think about all these topics and more as we figure out what is in it for us. So, Tanisha, before we get into DMX, the hot topic I want to discuss with you today is the passing of Prince Philip. So that's Queen Elizabeth's husband, which happened on the same day as the passing of DMX, which sent Black Twitter into a buzz, right? Because on the one hand, we are processing a grief that we will discuss in a moment. But on the other hand, Black folks have no chill when it comes to the royal family, because I think folks are still salty at the way Meghan Markle has been treated, the way Black people in London have been treated, the way the royal family has essentially like raped and pillaged the world, especially particular countries on the continent and the Caribbean. So I just felt like the sympathy factor for 99-year-old Prince Philip was a little null and void. What were you feeling when you were reading through Black Twitter?
Listen, people did not see it for him at all. And if you had any sympathy, you could catch a stray on that one. I mean, we saw what happened to Kerry Washington when she posted about the two of them, DMX and Prince Philip, being in conversation, and she had to end up deleting that tweet. So I was just like, listen, you know, our people know that your family, the firm, you all have done us wrong for centuries. So no, there was no sympathy. And of course, Black Twitter went in as Black Twitter can.
I cannot wait for, I know we're both academics, I can't wait for someone to write the scholarly work about the significance of Black Twitter. Because the way we are able to contextualize, like through the passage of Prince Philip, we are talking about diasporic relations. We're talking about colonialism. We're talking about racialized capitalism and the way Prince Philip, you know, sort of utilized patriarchy in this spectacular way. I mean, we're talking about Black don't crack. I mean, this man, I mean, as a human being, I was like, okay, I should hold space. There is a family somewhere that's grieving. Like, his children have lost a dad, a woman has lost her husband. And I knew better than to type that out there, because Black Twitter would be like, let me snatch all of these edges. We have no time for this 99-year-old man who has done God knows what and worse.
Right. And, you know, one of our colleagues, Meredith Clark, she's actually doing that work on Black Twitter and Black Twitter as a social media space, but also as a social media tool for news and reporting. But I knew that people were going to be prime whenever this man passed away, because I posted a story about Queen Elizabeth and how I believe it was Barbados was saying that, listen, we are going to take her. She's no longer going to be our queen, you know, and it got 100,000 likes. People are not seeing it for the British family, the British royal family. And so I knew. So when he passed away, I was not at all shocked.
And then you add in sort of last month with Meghan Markle and Oprah, and so bringing in a 21st century conversation about Blackness and this family, and basically how she's like, listen, they treated me like, you know, I was, you can't even say redheaded stepchild because her husband's a redhead. So like, she was like, they treated me like I was worse than the worst. And we know that, you know, she's biracial. Phenotypically, she tends to look more Anglo-Saxon. So if they weren't accepting that physicality, we know the Chrissies and Tanishas of the world better not roll up in Westminster Abbey, not never. Well, as with this and everything else, we will continue to think about what's in it for us, even with the passing of Prince Philip. Okay, so Tanisha, I want to start with the passage of Earl Simmons, also known as DMX, who passed away at 50 years old in White Plains after he'd been on life support for a few days, and he was fighting to the very end, according to his family. And, you know, the Yonkers rapper first made history kind of when we were coming of age, you know? I mean, there was so much of our, I think, college years that I think we can think back and remember sort of these hot songs in the club or wherever, you know, dances where we were, and, you know, hitting not just the Billboard charts, but like in so many ways, Black folks felt like he was ours, because in this era of like glitz and glamour and, you know, like puffy and sort of the, I would say some of the fashion that you discuss, DMX just kept it so raw and real. And even though he was rapping about things that I personally hadn't experienced, I knew they were part of this collective Black experience in some way. And he touched so many people, talking about essentially being in the carceral state starting at 7, you know, sort of being in a country that viewed him as a threat, a danger, and worthy of being thrown away from a child. And so he was able to like channel all of that, not just in his rhymes, but then over these amazing beats that made us really stop and reflect. And he remained consistent throughout his career in talking about that grief and pain. So I wanted to just check in with you, because I read some of the thoughtful tweets you had, really dissecting kind of the music industry and how they capitalize on Black pain, even when it's the artist that is in pain and just kind of waiting to sort of make more money, even after something happens to one of us.
Right. That was really important for me. You know, I didn't tweet very much when I first heard the news of X's passing, because as you said, he meant so much to so many of us who came of age listening to that music. And when he disclosed his battles with addiction and how he was introduced to crack cocaine, that was a story that so many of us grew up with. We knew aunts and uncles and cousins and brothers and sisters who too fell victim to hardcore drugs like crack. And so we knew him, we loved him, we embraced him. So I had to take a moment just to pause and reflect. But once I did, I became enraged at these systems of capitalism, the music industry being one of them, that willfully exploits our people, that exploits our pain in life and in death. They make a profit off of us. And while we know that DMX fought in many ways to maintain his own agency over his music, over his entity as an artist, that system, that machine, it's gruesome, and it eats us up and spits us out. And, you know, Azealia Banks, who is problematic, but, you know, she's my problematic fave, I have to admit that, she said some very poignant things that I wanted to reflect on about how the industry will oftentimes give you your biggest vices in order to get you to reach that place of pain that you can pull from in order to produce products that they're going to sell, while also denying you healthcare.
Yeah, and the help.
And help, you know? And so I wanted to think about that and hold those two things in tension. That there's a way that we can talk about the amazing man that DMX was to so many people in his own life, the fraught nature of his relationship, even with some of his family members and his children, and also the incredible art that he produced, while also thinking about these larger systems of exploitation.
And I think for me, what I'm appreciative of, I think when we, you know, we teach the youth of America and have the privilege of doing so, I think what made me so happy, I guess, was the verses that he had with Snoop Dogg, not too long ago, because I do think that that introduced him to a new audience. Because as you said, the industry, you know, he was nominated for 3 Grammys, but he never won. But there's so many Black artists that mean so much to Black culture that don't have the awards and the accolades, and we still need to sort of honor them in different ways.
Right. And I agree that that versus that moment of seeing DMX and Snoop in a space together, as we recognize the grief and the trauma and the hurt, we still have to find those places where we can find joy and express joy. And I think that that's why DMX's music is timeless, because he could do both of those things. And just by an inflection in his voice, right? Like,
he can this is great.
A whole emotional journey, you know?
Shout out to my 94 Camry that had plenty of DMX blasting with my gray carpet seats. But, you know, I think this point that you make up, about this joy and pain that Black people have to sit with sort of helps me move to our next topic, which is, you know, thinking about that video that was just released from December, right? So the video recording of military officer Caron Nazario, who was pulled over, and the brutality he experienced. And I think for me, he's in his military uniform and the pride that that uniform gives so many Black families, right? Because they know the hard work that it takes for their loved ones to go through this system. They know the physical and the mental hard work, because you're still in a white supremacist institution. And, you know, as a historian, you know, you're well aware of the way the uniform was used to lynch Black soldiers when they came back from the war. So this pride that Black people feel for having a family member representing this nation, a nation that sometimes doesn't even want us explicitly, but then also this immense pain where it's like, this man is in his car. He is all but minding his own business, having served our nation. And this is the brutality, the naked brutality that he experienced. It was in many ways too hard for me to process, because if it weren't on camera, we would never know, right? And then also just being so thankful that he's alive to talk about the anguish. Because we know that in an instant, it could have gone in a totally different direction, and his family and loved ones and friends and comrades would have been devastated.
A completely different direction. You know, these things can happen instantaneously. A routine traffic stop can end in Black death. And, you know, just to your point about the uniform, I'm writing right now about World War II era Black soldiers who come back mobilized, you know, as activists who say, you know, we're gonna come back and we're gonna serve our communities and we're gonna fight for greater rights for our community. Like Black soldiers who were an important part of the movement that we then called the Civil Rights Movement. Right. And I think about, even in my own family, the men in my family who served in the military, my grandfather, World War II era vet, my father, a Vietnam War era vet. And I think about how they do not have any of the so-called protections or benefits that are supposed to come along with service to your country. Mm-hmm. You know, and so to see this young officer be pulled over while wearing his uniform, and like you said, we didn't even get this video then.
No. So that also means the police officer had 4 months of salary and benefits, right? Because they've been fired, but that also means they had 4 months of receiving taxpayer money and putting money towards their pension that we're paying for as American citizens to pay for this brutality. Now, you said something, you know, which brings us, obviously we have to hold multiple things at once. So the backdrop of the Derek Chauvin trial, and then also in Minnesota, just a few days ago, we see a 20-year-old killed with his girlfriend in the car, by the way. So we're, you know, again, Philando Castile had his girlfriend and child in the car. We have, you know, another instance where now we've got Daunte Wright. He's killed in the car with his girlfriend right there. Accidentally, of course, because the police officer thought that she was going to have him ride the lightning and use her taser, and instead shoots him in broad daylight, apparently over, she says it's tags, but it could be air fresheners. And so we have these routine traffic stops, which obviously, you know, there's no such thing when it comes to Black people. But this idea that you said about how things change in an instant. So Black people don't have the luxury of just going to the store knowing for a fact that we'll be able to return. Going for a drive, knowing for a fact nothing's going to happen. This is why we, by and large, don't do extreme sports, right? Our extreme sport is going to the grocery store. Our extreme sport is driving a vehicle. Our extreme sport is trying to be Black in this country 24 hours a day.
And that's why, you know, I was irritated at tweets from people who were saying, well, you know, he should have known better not to move or not to try to, you know, resist the police. Well, as you said, there is no such thing as routine for us, right? And there's this system of charging us with petty misdemeanors, creating this system of fines, that are attached to warrants if the fines are not paid. And then you put Black folks in a situation where, what could happen to me if I'm pulled over and it's discovered that I have this warrant out for my arrest for something petty? What do we do? What are the recourses? So often we see Black people not left with no real recourses against the criminal injustice system, mm-hmm. right? And another thing that I was troubled by was, of course, this whole rationale, if we would want to even call it that, I don't, that the officer believed that she was pulling her taser, but it was her gun. Let's be clear, tasers are weapons of terror for law enforcement officers. Mm-hmm. They are. So even if this person did believe that they were reaching for a taser, they were reaching to inflict bodily harm on an African-American person. And Reuters did a study that said that Black Americans are more likely to die from engagements with police officers that involve a taser than any other race, right? Disproportionately, we die when we are tasered by law enforcement. And so to me, you know, this just became another of a long history of this kind of taser defense. And people are invoking the name of Oscar Grant as they should. But then there's also Eric Harris in Tulsa, Oklahoma. There's Akira Lewis in Lawrence, Kansas. I mean, there's so many cases like this where we see officers attempting to use a taser defense to explain away their use of lethal force.
Well, I think, you know, what's so important for all of us to remember, one, we have to protect our peace, right? Because we are holding a lot of things simultaneously. Officers who, or, you know, Black folks who didn't die at the hands of police, but we're still seeing these videos, and then those who have. I think we also have to remember, you know, you contextualize these institutional structures. How is it that a fine for $346 turns into a warrant, turns into something that now is a crime of quote unquote poverty is punishable by death? When we know it happens it doesn't happen to white people at all, but these ways that the state has made it such that our mere presence is a criminal act and they will tax it as needed to justify the incarceration of us. But if we are not incarcerated, then it also justifies the execution of us in broad daylight, because there were far too many people who were like, but you know, if George Floyd hadn't had that $20 bill, or if he hadn't resisted, I mean, there's always this excuse. If Tamir Rice, if Trayvon Martin, if Mike Brown had just gotten on the sidewalk, I mean, the ways that some folks, and I'm not gonna just say white folks, because we know that some of our own people do it, are comfortable with the execution of Black people by the state for petty misdemeanors is something that, as we think about what's in it for us, we have to make sure that we not just protect one another, but we have to protect our peace, because it's not just the institutional structures. It's also, this affects us watching these things, reading these things. This is why we have high blood pressure and hypertension. This is why, as you said, tasers do different things to our bodies, because we're carrying different things in our bodies from this trauma from the state.
Right. You know, that protection piece is really important. There's a way that we are inundated with Black death on the 24-hour news cycle, on our social media feeds. And, you know, I have a Black son who's not much older than Daunte. And I just wanted to hug him, you know? I just wanted to hug him because I know that it has nothing, is not my doing at all that that Black male child has survived to 25 years old, mm-hmm. you know? And my heart goes out to our people, you know? We have and continue to endure so much in this country. And I don't know. Yeah, it's just.
Yeah. No, I want you to just leave it at that. I think that that's powerful enough for our listeners to understand, because you don't have to be a mother, right? To know this. I mean, I know for mothers it is beyond difficult, but like as Black people, we feel all of this for one another. We know that our fancy degrees don't protect us. Our jobs don't protect us. Our neighborhoods don't protect us. It is, we are in this together. And yeah, as we think about how we move forward, I want to let you know that I'm holding you in my space, just as you do the work that you do to kind of contextualize historically how we understand and we see our place in this country and what's in it for us. Okay. So before I let you go, I want to know, what are you up to these days? What are you working on?
You know what, Chrissy? If I can stay off social media long enough, I'm working on a new book that looks at Black women who raise millions of dollars for social justice efforts in the middle of the 20th century. So I'm looking at how from the Great Depression to the Black Power Movement, it was Black women, grassroots fundraisers who supported what we call the Black Freedom Movement. And I'm looking at the hows and the whys and at what cost did they raise all this money for our freedom. So again, I'm trying to keep myself off of Twitter long enough to do that necessary work of book writing.
Well, promise us you'll come back once the book is all done and tell us all about it. I want to thank you so much, Dr. Tanisha Ford, for joining What's In It For Us today. Thank you so much for coming on. Thank you for listening to What's In It For Us. If you liked what you heard, please give us a 5-star review and subscribe to the show wherever you listen to your podcast and share it with everyone you know. Please email all questions, suggestions, and compliments to podcasts@thegrio.com. The What's In It For Us podcast is brought to you by The Grio and executive produced by Blue Talusma and produced by Abdul Kadus and Antonio Thompson. Mm-hmm.